Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 249. Emcomm? Just Emcomm? Little generic there, isn't it, Gary? Well, tell you what, let's do the official title as it came from the forum at the Charlotte Hamfest. Now, about a week and a half ago. Emergency communications, relationships with, and expectations of served agencies. That caught my attention. And they are going to talk about that. Some. It actually turns out to be a little bit more generic. I was kind of hoping for, you know, blood and guts and, you know, real meat and potatoes and digging in. A little more generic, but they get to that sort of stuff. Who is the they? Let's see if I got the, I got the picture up here. The they is Mike Patterson. I got to put it up here so I can point. That's Mike Patterson. He's KG4PDA, the Emergency Disaster Services Director for the Salvation Army of the Carolinas. And then the guy in the little window over here is Greg Hauser, W3FIE. And Greg is, I've got down here with the Communications Division of the Charlotte, North Carolina Fire Department. And I say with because as I was searching up who he was, I came across a progressively updated list of titles for him, and I'm not sure what the current one is. He's been working his way up from 911 dispatcher to, I think, you know, running the communications for the Charlotte Fire Department, I think. Let's see, where was I? Oh, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I want to say hello to all the Emcomm guys out there in the audience. Welcome to Ham Radio Now, here in episode 249. You've probably watched one or two others, as I showed off trucks and stuff like that. But I think there's this kind of division in ham radio. All the guys interested in the de-expeditions, they're gone. They never even tuned in. They saw Emcomm. Don't want to watch that. So you guys are here. So hello to all the Emcomm guys. and goodbye to everybody else. Lots of new hams coming into the ham radio hobby. And for you guys, more ham radio service, because that's what you want to do. And there's a lot of Emcomm professionals, like these two guys, getting ham radio licenses. I don't know if they got ham radio licenses just because they do Emcomm, but these guys are, their job is doing emergency services stuff. Mike with the Salvation Army, Greg with the fire department, their job is not doing ham radio for the Emcomm stuff. Trying to find out what I clunked my switcher pad. Let's me change cameras from the palm of my hand like that. I'm still getting over whatever I came back from Utah skiing with. Still deep in my throat. So let's see. Well, the FCC rules now allow these guys to do more training. Is anybody actually doing that? Is anybody doing the 72 hours a month, couple hours a week of training that these guys can now do as part of their jobs? I'm sure it's happening out there. I haven't heard anybody talking about it. Not that I hear everything. Let's see. There's new requirements and certifications in the amateur radio side of the Emcomm field. So I think that's got something to do with the sort of division that I believe is building up. And I may be wrong about that. So we'll see. But the hams within Emcomm are becoming more professional. We may be specializing Emcomm out of the realm of the average ham. Stay tuned to the end of the show. I'm going to talk about that. We'll get to these guys in just a minute. Some of what they're going to be talking about is pretty local, North and South Carolina. But I think that they have a lot of generic information in their talk that'll be of interest to anybody that's interested in doing Emcomm. And at the very least, you can compare what you guys do in your local area to what the guys here are doing in the Carolinas. As you watch this show, the title was, what was the title? Expectations. note the importance in those expectations of data. And we've heard this before. When all else fails, what emergency managers really want is to get their email working again. They're going to talk about that. And toward the end, Ham Frank Plush, W3FRP, he's the North Carolina AuxCom coordinator. What's that? We'll talk about that later on, too. Frank is going to say there are two data modes that you need if you want to do emergency communications here in North Carolina. Winlink and MT63. This is the first time I've heard anybody get real specific about a couple of data modes to be able to operate. In fact, I've done shows in the past where I've talked to guys, I think those Alabama guys, because they were doing something interesting. As I was driving back from one Huntsville Hamfest, they had a net on HF, and then they said, now we're going to go do the digital stuff. And I thought, well, cool. Haven't heard anybody else doing that. So I talked to them at the Hamfest later on and said, what digital modes do you specify? And they had kind of a handful. They weren't focusing on just a couple, like Winlink, which is a packet type mode, and MT63. They weren't being real specific about it. They were just experimenting, getting folks used to the idea. So we're making progress. I don't know if this is something that is spreading to the rest of the country or not. It's just the, it caught my attention because I've been looking for this sort of thing. I know that data modes are more important than most of us think they are. And that, you know, that thing, getting their email working, being able to pass message traffic more efficiently than doing it on voice. Your license is about to expire. I spell echo X-ray. So again, your state or jurisdiction may specify some other modes, maybe nothing at all, but it was kind of an interesting thing. You're also going to hear me off camera, safely off camera, ask Greg a question about interoperability. That's one of the big buzzwords in Emcomm on the professional side of things, but also on the ham radio side. So I'm going to talk more about that in just a moment. After we get back from the forum, and speaking of which, I do want to get you to the forum. And I do have a lot of Emcomm related stuff that I want to talk about. So I'm going to come back at the end of the show and spend a lot more time back there after these guys are done with the forum. And I've got an announcement that you Emcomm people might be interested in. So stay tuned. In the meantime, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. You guys pay for all the television equipment that I've got around me and the bandwidth and all that stuff. So if you're interested in the program, Arvin, the chief financial officer for Ham Radio Now and Amateur Radio Video News, that's where his name, Arvin, comes from. Our parent corporation, which is all really still just me, invite you to stop by this website here, hamradionow.tv. You'll see his icon. That's his icon over there, I think. Yeah, that's his icon there. I can never figure out what side of the screen it's supposed to be on, but I'm pretty sure it's supposed to be over there. Click on his icon and make a contribution either one time through PayPal or major credit card, or you can support us monthly through Patreon. Appreciate that very much. Thank you to all the guys who have done that. I know that it is more than just a quick thing to do. It takes a little bit of work, and you got to really like a show to send money, and a bunch of you do. So, thank you. Okay, tell you what. Let's go to Charlotte and check out Greg and Mike. Greg and Mike. I think I screwed that up. Yeah, no, Greg and Mike. Yeah, I got that right. And then I'll be back. So to Charlotte.
Good morning. I'm Stephen Burke, KI4FAQ, and want to welcome you to the start of this morning's forums. We've got some excellent forums today, and I'm very pleased today to have particularly start off with presenters that will bring a real-world situation for emergency communications. Our first is Mr. Mike Patterson. He's the Emergency Disaster Services Coordinator for the Salvation Army. He covers both North and South Carolina and has years of experience with the emergency communication component and will be able to speak to that very, very well. And also we have Greg Hauser, who's looming against the wall over here from the Charlotte Fire Department and the Communications Division. Greg also is a ham and understands the communication bridge we're trying to effect when we activate ARIES. So at this time, without any other comments, let me go then to Mike and let him take it. We are recording today, so just wanted to make you aware of that.
Good morning. Thank you, Stephen. And again, thank you to BFB and Charlotte Hamfest and for having us. And thank you all for joining us this morning. So as Stephen mentioned, I'm the Emergency Disaster Services Director for the Salvation Army. My area of responsibility is North and South Carolina. And just wanted to talk a little bit about the Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, W4CQ, and where we are located and how we work together. My association with the club goes back 15 years, 16 years now. I got my ticket September 2001 at the one of the ham fests, and did my first transmission at the Pentagon after 9/11. Been a part of the fellowship of the club and the amateur radio community, and so I just wanted to spend a little bit of time talking about our relationship together and a little bit about emergency communications and how we're positioned. So again, the Charlotte Amateur Radio Club, W4CQ, formed the club. The club was formed in 1972. The history's on our website. And Earl Gluck, that's his call sign, W4CQ. So we're proud to maintain that heritage. Fran Nakamura, some of you may know, W4ETF, was also one of the founding members of the club. So that's sort of just a picture of our operating station. It's at our divisional headquarters over on South Charlotte on Archdale Drive, which is where my office is located to cover the two states. And so it's our office building, and so we have a room. The club station is there, and so there's equipment for active HF, VHF, UHF as well. And some of the club members and officers are here with us this morning, so they'll keep me straight as well if I'm missing anything. So just another shot of the club station there. You see the beams on the roof. We have a little PVC pipe set up. Fran's ingenious engineering. We just installed that when we did the beams and then just run those cables right down into the room. And so we can switch out antennas, without having to, it's pretty easy. And so it makes it very convenient. There's not only the club space, the station space, but meeting space. It's an office where I'm located at divisional headquarters, and we have a couple of break room areas. And so there's a conference room, and we've done severe weather spotter training there as well, and the club's hosted various events. So the club members staff this station during an emergency. So that's what they kind of organize themselves to and orient to the club. Obviously, individual and family safety comes first. So that's primary, and sometimes folks just can't get out of their home or their neighborhood. But once family is taken care of, if the need should arise for our emergency communications room to stand up, that's where they would operate and function from. So to monitor emergency nets, obviously, one of the primary functions, to get set up and established portable generator, running extension cords, those kinds of things. But coordinating with Salvation Army personnel, i.e. me and my leadership, in the event of a major emergency. Our office location there, we sort of stage there early on, but most often we are mobilizing to where the disaster is. So we deploy an incident management assistance team to help manage the operations in the local areas. And that really is how we, our service delivery plan in the Salvation Army. We, again, we cover the two states. So there's, you know, 146 counties between the two states, and we have about 61 locations that serve throughout the two states. Our primary connection point is with those local Salvation Armies. And in many communities, you know, HAMs are a part of the local disaster team or a part of the community response. And so we want to make sure there's a connection there. And that's what W4CQ and the club could do, long distance, but also kind of localized connectivity if the need should arise. So for us, emergency communications, what does that mean? You know, you may be familiar with the incident command system, ICS, forms, just passing of information back and forth, particularly coordination of resources and personnel. And emergency traffic, you may be familiar with health and welfare and exchanging, passing along those that information as well. Certainly a lot of that is done electronically now and on websites, but that's a vital function even now. So that's one of the functions that the club would perform. Potentially EOC presence, so in the Emergency Operations Center. So a Salvation Army liaison may be required locally, again, with those local Salvation Armies, and they may be connecting with those local amateur radio operators in that EOC. And so sometimes there may be that need to facilitate that connection between that local Salvation Army, that local HAM, and the local EOC. And certainly W4CQ can help in that time as well. One of my main roles is in the Salvation Army is partnering with state emergency management. So we have liaison officers in both states, and HAMs are present in both states as well. So you never know who you'll be talking to or how through amateur radio, but that's the vital link in emergency communications. That's we're all kind of why we're here this morning. And then the Mecklenburg Aries liaison, Tony's here this morning, but our club officers would perform that role. Obviously, Tony would be pretty busy during times of emergency. So the Salvation Army's liaison to Aries would be one of the club officers from W4CQ. Certainly questions, comments, anything I'm missing, feel free as we go along. I know it's early in the morning and the coffee hasn't quite kicked in yet, but certainly don't let me rattle on, but I'm happy to do that. If there's questions, don't hesitate to ask. This is a picture of our tower trailer. Long story short, this was connected with an EF Johnson two-way radio system that years ago we purchased and had a network of radios, and then with the advent of Nextel, Sprint Nextel, those bands got bought out and the equipment became redundant. And so we had this tool basically on our property, and we weren't quite sure what to do with it. And then one of the club officers said, you know, we do this thing called Field Day, and we'd set up an antenna every year. Do you think that would be something we could use? And absolutely. So this has evolved into, it's an Aluma tower trailer. You may be familiar with the company. It's a 100-foot tower. Obviously, we don't set it up that high. We do it about half that at maximum for guy wires and safety and those kinds of things. But you can see the stabilization there. It's a self-contained package. There was a repeater in these cabinets, so there's an AC unit on the roof. But basically, it performs the tower function, the portable tower function. So it's been reinforced, the decking, and so it's a tremendously helpful tool, again, if we need to mobilize, particularly with field communications. This is just a snapshot of what the Salvation Army's presence looks like in the two states. That's our website there, salvationarmycarolinas.org. So if you need to reach out to your local Salvation Army representative, that's the best way to do that, is to go online to salvationarmycarolinas.org. And you can search your local Salvation Army representative. But basically, that's the two states, obviously. And the multicolors represent the counties in that Salvation Army location service area. So if you look in Charlotte, Mecklenburg, Union, their service area goes all the way up to Wilkes County. If you go to the coast, there's Wilmington, So we have Noon, Hanover, Pender, Bladen, Brunswick, and Columbus. So that's their service area. So when the disaster happens, that's their primary support. And so we exist at divisional headquarters to support them locally. And so because W4CQ is co-located with our divisional headquarters, when it's a major event and the disaster is across the two states, there's a natural connection communication point there. And then we can make an assessment as to what's needed. It may not be necessary to deploy to the field. It's primarily necessary to deploy to this club station and establish those communications as necessary. And sometimes it's just not necessary. We just had the floods in October in South Carolina. A lot of the communications infrastructure was pretty stable. So there was very little need for emergency communications, very localized, and where that need was, it was being addressed. So again, it's just awareness, situational awareness is what's primary and functional there. So just for a snapshot of what communications looks like in the Salvation Army, we do, based on commercial availability, cell phones, some folks use Sprint push-to-talk. That's our primary communications line, right? Phone, fax, internet, those kinds of things. Our Salvation Army locations rely on cell phones. Some use Sprint push-to-talk. We have no centralized business band radio system. We've just found it's expensive to maintain, and we rely on the commercial network, but hams are a vital communication network and resource, and we want to develop that relationship. And so that's through those local Salvation Armies, right? And some communities and some of the Salvation Armies, like here at our headquarters, there's space for meetings in a couple of communities. We're developing partnerships where to set up an antenna and those kinds of things. But it's establishing that relationship. And so we have some handheld satellite radios for key leadership in disaster services. And then some locations, again, have relationships with their amateur radio operators and their hams locally. We've hosted classes, tech classes, in some locations as well. And that establishes that relationship with that local club and that local Salvation Army, so that when it's their disaster and they're helping their community, they know one another, and they know what the needs are. They know where the facility is. They know where the emergency operations center is, and if there's a need for emergency communications, to have that support as a served agency, we're tremendously blessed to have that that offer and capability from our local hams. Some of you, and again, thanks to Stephen for the invitation and helping to guide our time this morning and our thoughts and my thoughts in preparing for today. Some of you had some questions, I'm sure, about Saturn, Salvation Army, not the car, Salvation Army Team Emergency Radio Network, which is essentially our national program for amateur radio operators affiliating with the Salvation Army. And so it's, again, through that network, those local Salvation Armies, and where I'm at the divisional headquarters, North and South Carolina, we're part of one division. The Salvation Army in the United States is organized in divisions. And so the SaturnNet, Saturn.org, there's more information available there. But certainly there's a registration process. But the main thing is to, again, facilitate communications, right? That's what hams do. That's what you all do, is take those tools, those skills, and those abilities and communicate and facilitate that communication, particularly during times of emergency. So these would be facilitated nets. There's the daily nets and the international nets and the frequencies there, Monday through Saturday, and the times. There's a weekly net for the Southern Territory. Basically, the Southern Territory includes everybody from the District of Columbia all the way over to Texas, up to Arkansas, Oklahoma, Alabama, Louisiana, Mississippi, Kentucky, Tennessee. So the 15 southern states in the District of Columbia. But again, informal nets, and they do this daily and on an ongoing basis, as you can see, for information sharing, fellowship, those kinds of things. But it's also good practice, right? The more often you do that, the more people are used to using the net and the frequencies. And so during state or national incidents, the Saturn nets, these frequencies would serve as our kind of main coordination nets nationwide and locally, obviously, within the states and those local operations. So, again, that's just sort of an information sharing path and tool. But, again, there's probably about 40 registered Saturn members between the two states, North and South Carolina. So, again, you don't have to be a member of Saturn to support the Salvation Army as a served agency, right? You're an amateur radio operator that's licensed, and you serve your community in times of disaster. And that may be helping the Red Cross, it may be helping emergency management or the Salvation Army, but Saturn is just a program that we developed to facilitate some structure and organization to volunteerism within the ham community. And certainly would encourage membership, but it's not a requirement to be supporting of the Salvation Army. And certainly we appreciate all that our hams do. The easiest way to connect with the Salvation Army, if you're interested in volunteering in emergency communications, in Saturn, in disaster services, is to connect with our local Salvation Armies. And the easiest way to do that is to go to our website, which is disaster.salvationarmyusa.org. So that's disaster.salvationarmyusa.org. And then just click on Join Our Team Volunteer. And you complete that, those step processes and information sharing as far as profile and contact information, interest in emergency communications or Saturn, disaster services. And then that information gets routed accordingly. And there will be an automated message that will come back from the system, but that will connect to the local Salvation Army. I'll see that information, and our territorial Saturn coordinator will also see that information, particularly as folks indicate, you have to indicate Saturn, interest in Saturn when you fill out that profile. So any questions on any of that? Again, just had to throw this disclaimer in because, again, all disasters are different. All disasters are local, and so it just looks a little bit differently in each community. But our headquarters in Charlotte isn't going anywhere. W4CQ and Charlotte Amateur Radio Club aren't going anywhere, and so our connection there with the club is a tremendous partnership. So this is the contact information for the club, the club website. Certainly, those of you that are affiliated with W4CQ, put your hands up. Any of these folks in the room can help you as well. And so there's my contact information, my email address, and the website for the Salvation Army in the Carolinas. Yes, sir.
I have a question. How does the disaster services of the Salvation Army tie in with other served agencies and their needs and so forth?
Yeah, so the map that I talked about is our service delivery plan. So that's our local Salvation Armies. You know, the Salvation Army is a church first and foremost, right? And so we have an administrative office, a church facility, and then our social services offices. So there's a presence in the community, and so there's a need to connect with those agencies and organizations that are helping us, that we partner in service every day. And then in disaster services, it's connecting with county emergency management, as well as the other agencies and organizations in those jurisdictions. So there may be opportunities for meetings, you know, where we're all around the table to talk about a disaster and planning, drills, exercises, real world events, you know, where there's, you know, ice storms and, you know, straight line wind events and those kinds of things. But it's that local community presence that's there daily is part of the connection with the local community and those other agencies and organizations that are doing disaster preparedness and service delivery.
Okay. So is there direct connections with like Red Cross and other served agencies?
Yeah, absolutely.
Or is it all through EOC?
It's both, right? There's a need to connect with county emergency management because, again, all disasters are local, but they're all different. And so everybody who's involved with disaster preparedness, response, recovery needs to be connecting with county emergency management. And then it's both in the planning for the capability and capacity in our communities. You know, our partners in the Red Cross do a fantastic job with sheltering. Sometimes there's a need for food support or other kinds of support and partnerships. And so it's that planning. And sometimes shelters are in schools, but sometimes they're in churches as well. So there's another potential partnership discussion to talk about just what is the plan. so that we're all on the same page. We're not duplicating efforts, right? We're not duplicating service delivery. Nobody can afford to do that. But we're coordinating, particularly so that we can leverage our capability and capacity as a whole community.
Great. Thank you, Mike.
Sure. Thank you. Other questions? Jim.
Yeah. I just might want to mention that it is a secure facility, but the officers have 24/7 access. So you do not have to be there.
Yeah, that's actually a great point. So it doesn't all rely on me as the Emergency Disaster Services Director. As you can imagine, I travel throughout the two states pretty extensively. So what we've done, because it's a, as Jim said, it's an office facility, it's a secured facility, the club officers have access to the facility, and so they can be present during their weekly meetings and monthly business meetings, but they have access, 24/7 access, basically, to the building in the times of emergency or if there's other projects that have to be done. So that's part of the plan and the planning process, and so that's part of the strength of the partnership. So it's really practical. That's a great point. Thank you. Well, again, one last thing before I go. Just want to turn things over to Greg, and if you would, just want to take a moment to thank Greg and all of his partners in Charlotte Fire and all of our other first responders that help keep us safe every day. So here's Greg.
Thank you, Mike. So I'm going to try and stay confined to this general area. I walk about and I talk with my hands, so I apologize up front to the folks viewing at home. But while they're getting the presentation set up, just a little bit about myself. My name is Greg Hauser. I recognize a lot of you in here. And to start off with, thank you for what you guys do, right? So amateur radio is an extremely important part of disaster communications. It's vital. So we're going to go through a couple of terms and things you'll see up here, but I'm going to give you a quick overview of what we do, right? So as Mike was saying, disasters begin and end at the local level. You have the clicker, Mike? No worries. Thank you, sir. So disasters begin and end at the local level, right? So what does that mean to us? When there is a disaster, everybody has to work together, right? It doesn't matter what patch you wear, or what your call sign is, or what agency you're with, or even if you're a member of the community, right? Everybody has to step up and help out. That's what I'm gonna talk about today. It's an honor. First, about my call sign, W3FIE, right? So I became an amateur radio operator 2006, 2007, right? And to start off, I'm an amateur radio operator, right? I get paid to talk on a public safety radio, but don't get a chance too often to talk on the amateur bands. But W3FIE, I married my wife in 2007, but I met her in 2003, and she told me, when I told her what I did, she said, oh, that's pretty cool. My grandfather used to be into amateur radio, and I used to have to knock on the on the basement door before going down there. And unfortunately, he passed away before I met him, and I wish I could have met him, but James Stone was my wife's grandfather from Philadelphia, and he was first licensed in the 1930s, and there's a picture of my grandfather-in-law in front of an old civil defense mobile command unit, so it's pretty funny how that all comes full circle, but that's his card from the 30s, so that's pretty neat. I figured you guys would enjoy that, but every time I key the radio as W3FIE, it's an honor for me to do that. So that's a little bit about me. So a little bit about the division, Charlotte Fire Department. I'm not going to read the slides for you. But we get paid to put fire trucks on the street as fast as possible. Right? That's my job. That's what the fire chief gives me as a standing order every single day. And I try my best to get help to those that need it. So when you call 911, you get my people. And we send help to you as fast as we can. And there's a little bit about the fire department. So the cool stuff, right, why I'm here to speak. We have a tactical communications team. It's about 8 to 10 members, right? They are responsible to get the training and then deploy when a disaster hits, right? Whether it's within the city of Charlotte or it's in the the region here, Cabarrus County maybe, or Union County, or state, or interstate. So you see those acronyms right there, COMMEL, COMT, INCM, TERT, OXCOM, right? Everything in disasters seems to be an acronym. They even have an acronym for the acronyms, right? You guys ever heard of the GOAT, the glossary of acronyms and terms? All right, so that's a, there is a document that FEMA produces that it's called the GOAT. So how many people in here are COMMELs? I know there's a, yeah, raise your hand, Marv. How many in here are COMTs? Again, Frank, right? And then there's other things. We'll get into those real quick, too, once we get down to that slide. So, and we support specialized teams. So there we have a regional deployable hazardous materials team that responds if it's needed. And we have an urban search and rescue team. Our job is to help the locals when they need it, okay? This is some of our equipment. And I'm a picture guy, right? So I like to see pictures. So we'll get away from the worded slides here in a moment. But we have five vehicles and two support assets, one of which was we house and take care of for the club in Mecklenburg County, and I'll show you some pictures there. But we have FieldCom 1-2, Mobile Command Post, a Mobile Operations Center, my vehicle, which is car 600, and then we have some deployment cash. So here's FieldCom 1, right? A lot of whiz-bang stuff. So that is our SATCOM truck. So we can get internet phones via satellites, a dedicated bandwidth for that. We can do, you see on the bottom here, for training, we did a video teleconference with Camp Victory in Iraq, and we had the families of the 82nd Airborne members from Charlotte that were deployed, and we had the folks that were overseas deployed and let them talk to each other. So it was pretty cool. It was a good way to for us to train and then use that training for benefit. So. FieldCom 2, it's just a pickup truck. And those that have been in disaster response before, this is sometimes what it ends up as, right? You throw all your toys out. As Mike said, you never really know what a disaster is going to bring, right? So you got to bring all of your cards to the table and then flip them all out and see what you can do. And I don't have to tell you guys that. That's your business. So there's our mobile command post. That's at the 4th of July fireworks in Charlotte. And there's our, we call that the Crystal Palace. It's the Mobile Operations Center. That is an 8-position communication center right there, and then a command room. Our first response for this unit was 2008 down to Lancaster County, South Carolina. They had a series of arson fires, and they needed some help, so we brought that down there for them. There's my vehicle. I carry the Urban Area Security Initiative's radio cache. So I carry a bunch of radios. You guys would love it. And it's out in the parking lot if you want to come pick around. So I carry about 170 radios of all different bands and frequencies and about 200 batteries. I also carry HF. And I think that bag right there is a buddy pole. So there you go. There's our mobile tower. We call it MT1. And you guys from the club recognize that. So that is a part of our deployment gear as well. And that's some of our folks using a wire for HF. So there's some of our USAR deployment cache, some of our SATCOMs. And this is one of our ham. He's not a, when I say ham, I mean he's hamming it up for the picture. We tell, hey, Jeffrey, do something, will you? So he'll point. That's his general pose. So here you go. So if we deploy, if we stand up, right, if something really, really bad happens, we don't want it to happen, but if it does, when it does, this is how we're going to interface. Okay, so have you guys ever heard the OXCOM, the term? Okay, excellent. As of yesterday afternoon, there are about 740 OXCOM qualified people in the state of North Carolina, and I can tell you on the national level, that is huge. That's a big deal. So for me, when I hear OXCOM, I know that you have an understanding of what the incident command structure is, and we'll talk about that a little bit. So this is what we could potentially ask from you guys as amateur radio operators. So everybody has a boss, right, in a disaster, it's kind of tough to say, but everybody reports to someone. In order to keep it flowing smooth, in order for communications to be coordinated, you have to report to someone. There's always a communications up and always a communications down, right? So you're always telling someone and you're always being told something from someone, right? How many folks were in the military? Thank you guys for your service. Chain of command, right? It's very similar in public safety and in a disaster. So what we'd be asking from you guys is packet data. That is huge now, right? If I can send paperwork over HF or a different means, I'm going to task amateur radio or OXCOM with that. I'm going to say, I have 10 documents I need to send to state EOC. You guys know where state EOC is? Raleigh, right? I can't remember the call sign up there, but Tom Brown, he's the godfather of the COMU in North Carolina. Don't tell him I said that, though. but he's the boss, right? So he's the OXCOM boss. So if I'm acting as a COML, I'm going to the OXCOM boss, and we're going to talk it out and see what the plan is. Fallback voice. I may say, my primary means of communicating in Charlotte is down. I need you to set up a means for me to dispatch fire trucks. I can give you that order, and I understand that you will do everything in your power to make that happen. That's why amateur radio is vital. And then situational awareness is huge. So here's some experience where public safety has had interaction with OXCOM to a benefit. So Hurricane Irene, I deployed to the Regional Communications Center in Kinston. When I arrived, they had zero comm, none. The lights were out, generator was down. to give you kind of a, without walking out of view of the camera, but to give you an idea, I walked into the room, it was quiet, dark, hot, and there was a lot of angry people, okay? So immediately someone picked up their head and said, are you the comm guy? I said, how should I answer this? But I thought to myself, this should be loud. There should be a lot going on. There should be phones ringing. There should be people. Oh, and their cell service was down as well. So the first thing I said was, where's your amateur radio operator? They said, we sent him home. I said, call him back and get him here. So Ron Knapp, W9EF, I can tell you that he was the linchpin to establishing communications out of that EOC. I called him back. He must have worked probably for about 20 hours straight, and I hated it, making him do it. But as soon as I found out there was a need, we made orders, right? So that's how it works. I immediately told someone and said, I need more amateur radio operators now. So that brought me Tom Brown, the godfather, Steve Mizell, Dwayne Harris. Frank came at some point, correct? Yeah. So that was a great success. And then that little political event that occurred, another huge win for amateur radio and OXCOM in the state of North Carolina. So secure comms, and we'll get into what secure is in my world. So activation scenarios, what we may ask, EOCs. How many have ever been to an EOC before, Emergency Operations Center? Hey, all right. Good job. What's going on in there?
Everything.
There's a lot of stuff going on, right? What do they normally do with you as an amateur radio operator? Put you in the corner, right? So it's my job to say, these guys need to be front and center with the boss next to me, right? It's vital. If no comms, no battle, right? That was an LA fire chief said that one time in a class. He said, if you have no comms, you have no battle, right? And there's the Secretary of Public Safety in the state of Alabama says, if you don't have comms, you're just camping, right? So think about that. There may be gear there for you, or you may bring your own gear. It depends, okay? Depends on security. Operational center activations, fire stations, utilities, infrastructure, I don't know, etc. Okay, so you may go somewhere you've never been before and you're going to have to figure it out. You may be in a mobile comm vehicle. You may be in your home. Okay, we'll get into that in a second. And then the you figure it out mode. So I'll give a problem, and I know amateur radio operators are the best at when they have to figure something out, right? That's when you guys shine. That's when you guys are your best. So operations during an activation, how you should act during an activation. Keep it simple, okay? My job is to keep things simple. If there's a means that I'm overlooking that I can get a message 3 miles down the road, if it's going to take you 45 minutes to set something up, I can have one of my young guns lace up some sneakers, I can write it on a message, and have them run the 3 miles, right? So keep it simple. If it's something that's, you don't have to wow us with your technical knowledge. We know it already, guys, all right? Don't hype the situation. Folks that have been forward deployed, downrange, there's a point at an operation where things level off, right? So things start to get quiet. Please let that play out. It's okay for things to be quiet. It means we've done our jobs, right? Please don't hype something because you don't hear anything. We had that happen in Irene, and we had to take action against that. People, your stress level is going to be high and elevated. It's okay for it to come down. That's how you rest, right? Mentally, not sleep, but mentally, you rejuvenate. Anybody in here ever heard of the term OPSEC? Oh, yeah, operational security. That's a big one when you're dealing with special events or law enforcement specific stuff. It doesn't mean post it on the club website. It doesn't mean, verbalize it over amateur radio on the airwaves. And expect to be told what to do. For some folks, that's difficult, right? It might be a step out of your normal day-to-day routine. Please don't freelance. Freelancing is extremely bad during a disaster, right? If I don't know where you are and I can't account for you, I'm assuming that you're in trouble, okay? So everything should be, you should always report your movements. If you're at home, make sure you're checking in. Don't give a message your own spin. Okay, that's another, you guys have all done the telephone game where at some point a message is inserted into the system and it comes out completely different. If you're given a message to pass it exactly how you have it. And you guys are good at that anyway, so. And keep notes. Keep good paperwork. That's important. Because at the end of the day, I'm going to ask you for some. If you're operating at home and you're a member of Oxcom, you should be keeping a 309 or some type of log, because I will call you and ask for it to put it in the overall ICS form paperwork. That's how we manage. That's how the state emergency management documents what occurred. Become educated. Mike was saying that you could volunteer for Saturn and Salvation Army. Get educated. Learn about those things. Right? Ask the questions. It's okay. FEMA ICS, it's all online. Ask how you can get involved. Ask about Oxcom. And any other COMU training out there. So what's next? There are COMU classes coming up. There's Oxcom offerings. I'm sure Tom and Frank are looking at progressing that program even more. Then we've got a new building coming down the pipe. been working with Tony, Mr. White back there. We want to make sure that in that building, Mecklenburg County Aries gets exactly what they need. So I can tell you that you guys are getting one of the largest rooms on the third floor in the EOC, and it's going to be directly with a open door to the floor for message passing. So you guys are going to be taken care of, and that's important to me. And you need to be prepared for the rainy days, right? It's not if a disaster is going to happen, it's when, whether it's man-made or a natural disaster. Got to be ready, right? You got to be planned for that. That's all I've got. So what do you guys have for me? I did bring my radio. I figured I needed to look the part and join you guys. And I can honestly tell you that I see John and Frank and Marv, and you guys are a lot of my mentors. So everybody says, well, who do you call, you know, if you don't know an answer to something? And I'm like, I have my little geek squad.
I came in a little late, so pardon me if you already covered it, but are there plans for the future or changes in communications techniques or systems that we might be interested in?
Sure, absolutely. Great question. So, I have this fancy Motorola APX radio. What is this radio now? It's a computer with an antenna, correct? So data is huge now. If you're at a disaster, it's no longer I need to talk with someone. Now it's I need you to get this to work, please. Yeah, I get it. I need you to make this work. I need to email. I need to get on and make contact. I need to make a post to a situational awareness tool via data. So a lot of our tasking now as disaster comms folks is to set up data. You guys know about public safety broadband. Have you guys heard about that? FirstNet? You guys heard that term? If not, you will. That's also a game changer coming down the line. It's going to be public safety broadband dedicated just for public safety. So, you know, that's something you can get online and research. But do you think Oxcom and amateur radio has a piece of that? I would imagine so, right? You can't put a tower in every backyard and make the magic happen, right? So thank you for what you guys do. And is there any other questions before I yield the time? Yes, sir.
We had heard some, I don't know if it's rumor or fact, about the changing incident command structure and where communications might be in that. Do you know any information about that you can share?
That's a great question. I can tell you what I think. I think communication should be a chief level position. So you have in the ICS, not to get an ICS class, but you have logistics, finance, operations, planning. All of those are the section chief level. I think there should be a communication section chief. Who knows where we fall right now in the ICS structure? Yeah, we fall under logistics, right? We fall under the logistics services branch or support branch, one of the branches. Right, so we're way down the line. So during Irene, I reported to the logistics section chief, and for the most part, he said, I don't know what you're talking about. Go right to that guy. So we bypassed that step. So any disaster or any other thing that involves ICS, you're going to be in the pocket of either the incident commander or the ops section chief. Because operations drives communications, right? And everything that we do in public safety, ops will drive comms. So that's only a natural progression. And I don't really know what they're doing on the national level, but I have heard some of my colleagues from other states saying that there is some type of initiative that they're working on to review that. So, sir, you have a question?
Yeah, I'm safely off camera.
Okay.
You said that you had a trunk full of radios, different bands, modes,
yeah,
like that. So what's the status of interoperability?
Interoperability, that's a buzzword, right? What is interoperability? Somebody answer that. What is interoperability? Anybody can talk to anybody.
Yeah, but can they?
Can they? Yes. I'll tell you what. We have human interoperability right now. That's what we're doing today. Right? Remember when I said keep it simple? Interoperability, you throw that word into the mix, everybody loses their mind. Okay? There's an interesting question that you need to ask when someone says, do you have interoperability? I say, why? Why do you need it? And who needs it? Right? There's a series of questions that you need to ask or answer. Well, I need to talk to all these people. Well, what are you trying to do first? Well, I need to get this message here. Well, a lot of times, and this is kind of, I'm not trying to be a smarty pants, but a lot of times you grab them by the hand and you walk them over to that person and you say, talk directly to them. I have a funny picture from the Super Bowl in Glendale, Arizona, where there is a sheriff standing this way, sheriff's deputy, and a city police officer this way, back to back, transmitting on a radio. So I said, "What? Just turn around. You can tell them." So, interoperability, there's many different ways you can describe that. There's data interoperability, voice interoperability, human interoperability. Yes. So there's, how many people in here have ever heard of the term gateway? All right. Be very, very, very careful about gateways. Sure. So we carry a gateway. We actually have three gateways, one vehicular gateway and then two Pelican cases. If you are activating those gateways, you have exhausted every other means of potentially communicating with someone. That is our last option, is a gateway. Great tools, but in the wrong hands, you can really hose up an operation. So But in public safety, we have built-in communications, whether it be shared talk groups or shared frequencies, mutual aid, it's called, mutual aid frequencies. And all of those need to be governed by policy. So you can't just get on those frequencies or talk groups and just start having at it. So very good question. What else you got, sir?
Just add to that.
Yes.
We as ham radio operators in the state of North Carolina can do a lot from a data interoperability perspective to focus on two things. Be proficient with WinLink and be proficient with FLDigi or whatever using MyTango 63, MP63. We don't use PSK31, we don't use Olivia, we don't use anything else. We're either using MP63 for digital or WinLink. And if you're not doing those two things right now and have it and use it proficiently, that is something you need to come up to speed on from an interoperability perspective. Because when we have an incident, we need to communicate. We could have really bad voice communications, but we can still get through with digital. So just not to beat the drum too loud or too long, WinLink and MP63. Yes, sir.
You said MP63?
Yes, sir. It can be FLDigi, can be HRD, whatever your application of choice. But one of the things that I find, as Greg said, we're all innovators. There's all kinds of different tools that are out there, so we have to come to common ground. Just like in the public safety radio systems, there's standards, there's APCO, there's P25, 800 megahertz. There's a way of doing that. It's very structured, and it's very well defined for that interoperability. Well, all right, I don't want to go too far off it. Anyway, but from a ham radio perspective, we've got a ton of applications out there to do things, and they're all great, and they all have their own benefits or whatever. But again, we have to have common ground, and we do that by standardizing on using WinLink to pass email messages, or if we need to send something out, like a point-to-multipoint, if we're using FLDigi with FLAMP or one of those things, if you're really familiar with the one-to-many distribution of ICS form data, it's a huge step forward if you can get those two under your belt and use them consistently. Don't use it once and put it away, because software versions change, conditions change, etc. So sorry to steal your thunder there, Greg.
No, sir. That's why I call him. I call that guy because I got about 3 out of every 10 words that he just said there. But that's the point. The point of this session is that as a communications unit leader for the state of North Carolina, I don't have to know it all. If I think I know it all, I have no business doing what I'm doing, right? So my job as a COML in North Carolina is effectively managed through others, right? So that is the good point, and I think Michael will also agree, is that in the emergency management world, if you don't have a stack of cards in your pocket, you're way behind the game. So folks, thank you. Hey, one more question. From a COML, yes, sir.
The users of truck tracking systems.
Yes.
Do they have any type of simplex operation direct where they can talk vehicle to vehicle or to headquarters?
Awesome. Great question. Yes, absolutely. Right. So we have fallback procedures as well in the trunking world. And do you guys know what the NIFOG is? You guys ever heard that term? The National Interoperability Field Operations Guide? You can go online and Google it, NIFOG. Version, I think it's a 0.6 version, I think.
Right next to the AUXFOG.
Right next to the AUXFOG, which you need to download. The godfather, Tom Brown, assisted in making that national document. Great document. Get those two documents, read them. There are certain rules that apply.
Say their names again, just one more time.
Sure.
NIFOG.
Yep, FOG, Field Operations Guide. And then the AUXFOG, AUXFOG.
You can find those on publicsafetytools.info.
Publicsafetytools.info, and that goes for the folks at home as well who are watching on YouTube. Publicsafetytools.info. And yes, we use for firefighter safety, we use 8TAC93 direct in every single Charlotte Fire Department radio. It is spun all the way to the end on your dial and back one. The last channel on the dial on a radio is always an emergency channel. So if they're in a mayday situation and they're pinned, they can either hit a button or spin their dial all the way. They have a direct line to a dispatcher, or if they go back one, they can talk separate of the trunk system. So if they're out of range or in a building, they can still communicate. So good question. Yeah, always talk. Again, keep it simple, right? There's a lot of magic that happens in a trunk system. So one more question, then we got to wrap it up. I'm going to get in trouble.
Have you planned or have you already placed any ham radio equipment at fire stations? Because you don't want to be worried about having to put up an antenna at the last minute.
All right, I'll try and tiptoe around this. All right, so no, we do not pre-station any amateur radio equipment at fire stations, and I can tell you why. And this is no disrespect to any firefighters that are watching on YouTube or who are amateur radio operators or are in the crowd. If I put something in a firehouse, a firefighter is either going to tear it into 7,000 pieces. They're going to need one type of screw that is on the top of the thing, and they're going to borrow it, or it'll end up in the complete opposite side of the station that it was intended to be at, right? So that's why we don't do it. Plus, I can't guarantee you that it's going to work when you get there. That's why I would rather have you bring what you are comfortable with to the fire station and help us. So, and all that, we're working further down the line and planning and things like that. We need to work on that, and at least in Mecklenburg County, that's something that we need to work on. So thank you. It's an honor to stand in front of you folks and speak.
Thanks to both of these for being here today and making such a great presentation. And I'm certain they'll be available after today's discussion if you have any other questions you'd like to address with them. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Well, thank you, guys. So I said that I had some more stuff to talk about. Well, first, let me dig into that question on interoperability. And I really didn't get the answer that I was looking for. But Greg did make some good points. You absolutely do not want everybody talking to everybody. That would be chaos on any given radio channel. You do want the people who want to be able to speak together to be able to do that quickly and easily. And what I was wondering is how close we are to that goal. I've got a co-host down there bopping about my feet.
Okay, it's the mouse.
I was waiting for her to reach up and start clawing my legs, but we'll get her going here right away. You want to sit back there? There you go. All right. So the mouse is now the co-host again. You want people to be able to speak together when they need to. You want to do it quickly and efficiently. And I was wondering how close we are to that goal. Do the radio systems out there support it well at this point? Remember that Greg said he had a trunk full of radios on different bands and modes and systems. So that indicates that at least to some extent, it's still Tower of Babel. There's folks who can't talk to each other easily. And also, do people, the first responders, the public safety people, police officers, fire department, firemen, EMS, medics, and et cetera, do they all know how to use this stuff in terms of being able to intercommunicate with other people? Now, I had a strange situation that I was listening to on a scanner. This is a couple of years ago, so things have probably improved a bunch since then. You don't get this kind of thing on a scanner very often, where you're able to track an incident from agency to agency, and it's, scanning is not like getting play-by-play. Anybody who is into scanning, and I want to do a show on scanning sometime soon, they'll tell you it's like you're there. You're listening to the incident. No, it's not. You're not getting a play-by-play. In fact, if you hear the sirens go by, you're too late. All of the useful information is pretty much passed on by. You may get some follow-up information when responders arrive someplace, but their job is not to tell the dispatcher, well, here's what we found. It's to work with the people who are there. So you often don't, mouse is button me. Yeah, mouse. I'm not paying attention enough to the mouse. You don't hear them say, well, here's exactly what happened. There was a terrible accident and there's people lying on the street and we're, you know, you might hear them say, we need a couple more ambulances. You don't hear that very often, but this time I did. And it's because I heard a dispatch of a police department to an accident that had multiple injuries. Then I heard the EMS on their frequency, different channel, request an air ambulance. And then I heard the helicopter talking to their dispatcher about trying to establish a landing zone. And I didn't hear any of these people talking to each other. All of the information was being relayed through dispatchers and phone calls, and nothing on the radio. No one, they didn't go to one common frequency and start working together. I don't think these agencies had a common frequency at that point. I have often heard agencies using common frequencies. Our local 800 megahertz trunking system has mutual aid frequencies, and particularly EMS, when they bring in folks from out of town, from the next town over, they'll communicate. They'll go to mutual aid. Maybe a police officer or fire department will show up there. For the very local stuff, that's pretty much now all in place. And I'm no expert on it. I don't work in that field. Just kind of interested. I do wonder, there also have been times, especially when things have been being brought in from a wider area, where sometimes ham radio has ended up being the bridge. You got a ham with each of these various agencies, if it's a big deal. And they're the only ones who can communicate on a common frequency. So I suppose that still happens from time to time. I don't know. Mouse is down here in my lap now. She's probably not going to last long, but that's what's got my hands occupied. Okay, so a little bit more generally, I am very interested in Emcomm. I have participated in my county and state areas group since I moved to North Carolina way back in 1990, so about 26 years now. Raleigh, the city that I lived in, and the city just, you know, I'm in a suburb now, but I'm close to Raleigh. It's the state capital, so the state EOC, the Emergency Operations Center, is there. My main job, because I was a media type guy, was immediately tapped to be the public information officer. I was the PIO for Wake County Aries. I was the PIC, the Public Information Coordinator. That's the state level ARRL position for a few years. But I also logged a lot of hours manning the EOC stations, mostly the state EOC station, and mostly during hurricanes. It's our big MCOM thing here on the southeast. I had one serious deployment that got me out of town during Hurricane Isabel in 2003. Ended up helping out at a very rural county's 911 center, the tower for that county, which had all of their public safety radio stuff on it, all on one tower, had fallen over. A hurricane knocked it over, and their 911 center was out. So hams were manning the fire stations, and I was dispatched to the 911 center. They didn't have any actual radios there. Everything was wireline to that tower. I received my ICS certificates. That's some of that. It's not really new now. You know, they've been going on for a while. But after incident command structure was developed, hams needed to get these certificates. So I've got the 100, 200, 700, 800B, this one here. And apparently I got something called 802. I don't really remember 802, but apparently I've got it. I went through them quickly. It's an online thing. It's an open book test. You do have to pass a test, but you can go back and refer to any notes that you made or the actual test material. So for me, passing that was mostly an exercise in doing good word searches, saying, well, they want to know about something. Here are the words. They used somewhat different language in the exam than they did in the tutorial. So I had to be clever and find my way back because I didn't remember what some of the answers were. What I remember from the courses is that there's a lot of organization charts, a lot of acronyms, a lot of nomenclature, not very much how to do things, not very much hands-on. And I'm told that other certifications that are available through FEMA do cover more hands-on how we work together and how we do things in terms of communications. But I haven't been doing those. What those courses that I took, the 1-700-800, what they cover is important. I don't remember most of it. So what I remain aware of, just aware of, without having an in-depth knowledge of how this works, is that there is an organizational structure. Before ICS, there wasn't. Everything was handled sort of slapdash and, you know, had on the fly. Some areas were more organized than others. So ICS was kind of not just overlaid on every jurisdiction, but you know, saying don't do things the way you used to do them anymore. Do them this way. And your federal funding is going to be at stake if you don't. It was badly needed. Hams have a place in the ICS structure. And I'm told when I tell people who are more deep into this that, you know, all I remember from this is that there's a structure and that I would be part of it, but I don't really remember very much about what it is, and it was org charts and acronyms. They say, you remember enough. You'll get it once you get there. You can get lots deeper into this structure. There are classes, the additional certifications. There's participation. You might have remembered Greg in the forum talking about COM-L and COM-T, positions that are somewhere between amateur and professional within the ICS structure. Do you know what those are? If you do, you know, raise your hand. I'm seeing a few hands go up. But when I started Ham Radio Now, my Aries participation dropped to about zero. I still check into the North Carolina Aries net on 75 meters, a Tar Heeley emergency net, now and then, you know, once a month or so, mostly mobile. It's a voice net on 75 meters. I'm proud of a couple things. And when I'm out of town, I try to check in from Dayton. I've checked in from Chicago. This is mobile on 75 meters and not necessarily in the middle of the night. The band is just, you know, at twilight, the band is starting to open up. The biggest DX, and I think I surprised the hell out of these guys, is I checked in from Lincoln, Nebraska, halfway across the country, mobile on 75 meters. The North Carolina was pretty much in the night at that point. Lincoln was twilight. So that was fun. So mostly I don't have time. Ham Radio Now takes up about all the time that I'm willing to dedicate to ham radio. The station back there doesn't see anywhere near as much activity as an average ham would like to give it, as I would like to give it. Most of my operating is still from the car. If I'm not listening to podcasts, I'll turn the radios on and play with them. I have a little bit of a conflict of interest with doing Aries stuff. Here with Ham Radio Now, I am pretending to be a journalist, which is not the same thing as being a PIO. My access to the operations and to the EOCs was making the ECs, the emergency coordinators, the guys I was working for, was making them a little bit nervous. EOCs have been tightening access. They keep the press, the working press, pinned in a corral, at least here in North Carolina. The press, journalists, newspaper, TV folks used to walk around the EOC almost at will, but not anymore. They've got a place to go, and they get press conferences. And if they're going to go into the operation center specifically, they've always got an escort. So being a ham journalist was becoming a difficult dual identity. And I didn't really got the stink eye at my video cameras. So I'm still very interested, but I'm not participating much. I think I'm still listed in among the group of folks that have passed the search and qualified to go, but I haven't been going to their meetings and haven't been actively participating. If something comes up, I will help if I can, but if a hurricane comes by North Carolina, and one will, maybe not this year, hope not this year, but one will, my main goal is to get my video camera stuff out and document what hams are doing, not provide the emergency communications myself. If I'm in the right place at the right time, I'll do what I can, but I want to get what we're doing on camera. And that again is becoming somewhat more difficult to do because getting into the EOCs is becoming more difficult. Used to be easy just because I was a ham. I got in. All right. So now, on this program, by the way, I buried the lead. Here's the lead. Now, besides it being an Emcomm episode, I am thinking hard about doing a monthly episode of Ham Radio Now, just on Emcomm. The working title, Emcomm Extra. I don't know what's extra about it. That's the alliteration, you know, appeals to me, and the idea that it's something kind of cool and something kind of different. There's really nothing extra, but a monthly show, I usually do a show a week and maybe like one and a quarter shows a week. One of them a month would be Emcomm related. Haven't tried this before, doing a regular program feature. I am not that organized. Very hard to do. But there's a lot of Emcomm news. There's a lot of new hams, again, who have gotten into ham radio just to be able to do Emcomm stuff. And I think this isn't the only journalism that covers Emcomm, but most of it isn't really journalism. Most of it is it's house organ stuff. It's ARRL, QST, CQ, websites, mailing lists, announcements, it's all internal stuff. It's not somebody looking at things with a journalist's eye from the outside. That's kind of what I want to do. And part of the reason is that I get frustrated that just about all the stories that I see about Emcomm, QST, CQ, and for this, I'm going to point a finger specifically at Newsline. And just because I'm going to criticize Newsline about something doesn't mean I don't like them. Doesn't mean I don't like the guys. I know in this era of the black and white, it's either you're firm or against them, some people will take this wrong. But in the stories about ham radio participation in emergency communications, we kind of inflate what we do. The stories are poorly reported. It's like we don't offer a lot of details, but we get all excited and ginned up about the fact that we did something. Here, especially Newsline, they'll offer, I wrote down here lurid descriptions. I may want to take that back a little bit. But they do. They build up the general media descriptions about how bad the situation was. A flood, an earthquake, a hurricane, a tornado outbreak. All of the catastrophe and the human carnage and all the damage and stuff. And then the stories a little too often conclude with, "And hams were standing by just in case they were needed." But they weren't. Sometimes we actually do something. And when we do, you really don't get very many details about what we did or how we did it. And we just about never hear how well or how badly it went. So I'd like to get some of those stories, and I'd like to do them in the usual Ham Radio Now style, in depth and warts and all. That's what I would like to do. Unfortunately, this would be mostly a talking head show, another Skype interview show. I would love to get my cameras in the field. And again, if I can, I will. But I don't really have the time, the money, or the other resources to be able to do that very much. Maybe I could attract some field producers, some of you guys out there that have the technology and the skills to be able to document something that's happening in your area when it happens, either an actual event or just training. Training is easier because you know it's coming and you can prepare a little bit more. I don't expect it. This has not happened before. I was mentioning in the show with Dr. Jim Boner and Jeff Parker from the Charlotte Hamfest that I was commiserating with Bill Pasternak, the Silent Key, the founder of Newsline, how little documentation there is of actual ham radio communication. Not really a lot of good still pictures and just about no video. A lot of this conversation came up when they were trying to put together the Walter Cronkite, This Is Amateur Radio, program. It, was based to some extent on wildfires that were happening out west. And they used that as an opportunity, but they had to stage a lot of stuff because there weren't any hams out there getting footage and documentation of what they were doing. And I was telling Neil Rapp when I was started Ham Radio Now, it was because I wanted to get some things done and was frustrated that it wasn't happening. In East Texas, when the, I keep mixing up the Challenger and Columbia, the space shuttle that disintegrated is on reentry over East Texas and scattered parts all over East Texas. I forgot to mention on Neil's show that the thing that was happening there was hams were providing all the communications because the agencies, the state agencies, the local agencies, the federal agencies all came rushing in. And this was part of the recovery effort to find all of the pieces of the shuttle that had rained down in East Texas and get them all and, you know, collect them and bring them in. So they weren't lying out there as pursuit bear hunters, and also for analysis to see if they could figure out what had gone wrong. But they couldn't talk to each other. It was very rural. There weren't very many public safety agency repeaters. And those that were there, only a few agencies could use them because their radios weren't programmed or capable of using them. Even the highway patrol, the state police people that came out there, although they had the same frequencies, they didn't have the same subaudible tones, the same PL tones. So they could hear, but they couldn't talk. And they couldn't get their radios changed, reprogrammed to be able to do that quickly and efficiently. But there were some ham radio repeaters that covered most of the territory pretty well. And so they brought hams in. I would have liked to have gone there and covered that. Turns out I would not have been able to. They had that stuff locked down in terms of media. So there wasn't, a ham with a camera saying, I'm, you know, doing a TV show. I wouldn't have had access. So, you know, not so bad that I wasn't able to do it, but it was one of the things that spurred me to get started doing this. And I have actually been out on the road on programs that I never finished producing. I chased when I couldn't get to Hurricane Katrina. A couple of years later, there was another hurricane that was barreling down on the Gulf Coast. It looked like it was going to be bad. Turns out it wasn't so bad, but I went. I was able to get away, and I got as far as Mobile, Alabama, and stopped and shot some video in a few places. But that hurricane kind of petered out. I mean, it was bad. Any hurricane is bad, but the ham radio participation was nothing like what happened in Katrina. And as that was winding down, there was another hurricane that ended up heading toward North Carolina. So I came back the same trip. I think I was gone for like almost two and a half weeks and talked to a bunch of people in North Carolina. That hurricane also kind of fizzled out. So I didn't make programs out of those. Still have some footage. Probably should dig it out. Probably should have dug it out for this, but I didn't plan for it. Okay, so where was I? Okay, so if you're hanging in here with me, put this stuff at the end of the show. And I did it for a reason. And like I'm saying, it would be good if I could find some field producers, some of you guys that are willing to put skills and equipment to use in actually documenting actual activities or drills and showing what people do without all the, you know, blowing it up to a lot more than it really is. We do something good. Our participation is valuable. We don't have to exaggerate what we do. One more thing. I want a co-host for this show. I want somebody to do the show with me. So consider this to be a casting call, an open call to you hams out there. The folks that are still watching this program, something has attracted your attention. And so you are the folks that I want to talk to. And maybe one of you would be interested in doing this monthly program along with me. Some of you just like listening to me talk. You guys, just keep listening. So what's the deal? I'm lost in my notes here. Qualifications. You're already interested in the topic, so that's a good start. You are not necessarily the expert. We'll be talking to the experts. I'm certainly not an expert. You know, my experience is old and getting older. Yours is probably more current, but I don't want you to be the expert. We'll use your expertise and your knowledge to be able to craft good questions, find good people to talk to, but it's not going to just be you sitting there with me asking you questions as the expert. You're the journalist. You are curious. You are able to translate that curiosity into a show, doing interviews and conversations. You are not necessarily a broadcast professional. I don't want anybody showing me up. I'm the broadcast professional. Your technical qualifications, we'll need a few of those. You need Skype video. It doesn't have to be like this studio. You know, you don't need all this stuff sitting around you. you just need, it's like the micro cam here. Oops, there we go, the micro cam. That's about all you need, $80 Logitech camera. You need decent audio. It doesn't have to be the Heil PR40. A good mic for podcasting is about $100. So for $250, if you're starting from scratch, you're going to be able to meet the technical qualifications. You need good bandwidth if we're going to do a Skype video show. Preferably something in the vicinity of an internet service that gives you 5 megabits per second upload, not download. And since most internet service providers pretty much tell you how great their download is, so you can watch Netflix, you know, 20, 30, 40 megabits per second, but they don't say so much about the uplink. You can find out, but you have to dig a little bit for it. So 5 megabits or so up is kind of the minimum. Interested? Send me email, kn4aq at arvn.tv. I don't have a ham radio now TV address. KN4AQ at arvn.tv. And we will talk. And if you're in the running, if you're even close to someone who would be able to do something like this, then we'll talk on Skype and see how that works. Let me give you a taste of what an MCOM show might be like. Let's see. So you remember Frank Plesch and 3FRP was talking about those two specific data modes, WinLink and MT63. I don't have either one of those here. I don't know a lot about them. Back in the day, I ran a VHF packet. I used some RDI on HF. I've used PSK31 on HF. That's kind of the limit of my data modes on HF and VHF. And it's getting pretty old. You look back at the station here, I've got the the Wirecast computer sitting here. The station itself, there's no computer back there. I don't have one to spare. I'm about to retire a laptop from business service and replace it with something else, and that laptop will probably go back here. So I have a computer. But I've gotten curious about these data modes. I think that most hams who are interested in Emcomm still pretty much just have voice. Some of you still do CW, which is probably a better way to send messages than voice, but yeah, it's still, you know, it's getting pretty old. I don't think that very many of you are deep into the data modes. Are you? Tell me, because I don't think that a lot of you are, but again, I'm kind of disconnected these days. But remember, emergency management says they want to get their email going again. And some of those systems, so the WinLink system in particular, has the technology to tap into a local area network, their Wi-Fi or their Ethernet network. And when, you know, the pipe to the internet service out there in the world is gone dark, the ham radio connection can use VHF or HF and get the internet, the data flowing again, not 100 megabits per second. They're not going to be sitting in the EOC watching YouTube videos or Netflix with a ham radio connection. And they type up an email and attach a 5 megabit picture to it or megabyte picture to it. That's going to take a long time to send. So they'll be discouraged from doing those sorts of things. They can type up a quick email and push the go button and it gets sent. Now it won't show up on the other end in 4 seconds like it would over the internet. It might take a minute or 5 or 10, but that's better than never showing up at all. So those things are happening. But how many of you are actually capable of doing it, capable of getting yourself into the EOC area and setting that stuff up for them and making it work? Where do we stand on that sort of thing? Well, I know that in North Carolina, there was a big effort to get WinLink running at the state EOC and to regional EOCs. We've got area branch offices in 4 parts of the state, and they wanted the WinLink to be able to work to those. And there's a couple of other things that are places that they specifically wanted them. And then after that, county EOCs, as many as they can get online, but they're, you know, that's secondary. I don't think that effort involved many routine ARIES members. As it was getting started, I was still somewhat participating, and we had progress reports described to us, but there's only a few people that are actually working on it. And us routine ARIES members weren't working on it. They may have some ARIES members being trained on that system now that I'm no longer part of, but it was fairly limited. This is interesting. They considered the ham bands unreliable. The ham bands and the facilities, the WinLink stations, the fixed stations, unreliable. So not totally unreliable, just not reliable as they wanted it to be. So they're actually using Mars systems and frequencies. So that's what I know. There's a lot more that I don't know. I don't know if they're using any ham radio frequencies at all for data. I do know that WinLink is an error-free mode. It has ACKs, acknowledgements, and retries if some data doesn't come through right. I know that MT63 does not. And I think Frank specifically said they don't use PSK31. MT63 is more robust, has forward error correction, fairly fast. I did a little bit of research. I've never used MT63, just a little bit of research. There's multiple options with different bandwidths. It's generally kind of wide. You know, it's not PSK31, you know, where it's just this tiny little signal. It's 500 hertz, 1 kilohertz wide, some of the options, you know, similar to wide shift RDI. I don't know what North Carolina is doing with it. You know, Frank said it's one of the two modes that you want to have, and I don't know what they're doing with it. I do have a little demo pulled off of YouTube. So here's some guys that are doing an MT63 contact. Let me see if I can make that play. So the audio just, you know, kind of noise. You know, this is what data sounds like when it's fairly wide band. Just it sounds a lot like noise. So I've seen that message. I don't know if that's as fast as it goes. And you know, this is just somebody's MT63 demo that they put on YouTube. And there weren't a lot of them, so I looked around. My YouTube is attempting to show me other stuff here now. YouTube does that. Videos by K2MO. I guess I should go look at his sometime. Been led to them by YouTube. I don't know what other Emcomm groups around the rest of the country are doing, you know. So are you doing data modes? Are your people deeply involved in them? Or do most of you just hang out, checking into the 75-meter net at night and maybe a 2-meter net once a week? I don't know. Well, let's find out. The push toward data modes, is it leaving hams behind? Is it because it's less fun? Are you just kind of like being a telephone operator? Or worse, are you just tending an automated transmitter that's sucking messages in from VHF or the internet or something and spitting them back out automated so that, you know, all you're doing is watching the lights blink, making sure that things work? What is happening out there? That's what I would like this program to be able to do. So, you know, you get the idea. This is not just one show's worth of content. It's an ongoing discussion. One more thing. Mention the term AuxCom. What is AuxCom? The term popped up here in North Carolina a few years ago. As I was traveling to conferences and hamfests, I asked hams in other areas if they'd even heard the term, and as of a few years ago, they hadn't. So now maybe more people have. If you do a search for it on the web, you come up with some different things. This is something that hit with my AuxCom search. The ARRL South Texas section describes it, AuxCom with 1M, as a communications course developed by the Department of Homeland Security, their Office of Emergency Communications, that focuses on radio communication and provides a broad knowledge of the fundamental principles of communication systems used by emergency management agencies. It aligns with both ICS and NIMS. So that's what Texas's AuxCom connection is. It's courses that lead you through the certifications and beyond to something more significant. Here in North Carolina, AuxCom has something more. It's more of an organizational thing beyond just courses. It's got the courses and stuff, but it's more a deeper organization. Area 10 is counties in the middle of the state. And I'm not going to go deep into this other than just to point out that it's there. This is the website for the Area 10, North Carolina areas folks. And so they're talking about AuxCom. Mitchell County, North Carolina, just one county, calls their emergency system, amateur radio emergency service, and auxiliary emergency communication. And their AuxCom has 2 M's. Is this one? I'm looking for, yeah, their AuxCom here for Area 10 has 2 M's. This has got 2 M's. South Carolina. Well, here we've even got a logo for AuxCom. Again, 2 M's. So South Carolina is getting a little deeper into the organizational aspect of it. And this is something I've been pretty aware of, is that in the organizational side of Oxcom, it is not just ham radio. It is the other services that can provide additional, you know, auxiliary backup communications to emergency management. So here they're talking about RACES, MARS, ARIES. I'm not sure what the South Carolina Defense Force is, but I've heard it described that that some communications from the National Guard could be part of it. So it becomes sort of an umbrella for emergency services, and then all of those become available to emergency management, and they pick and choose what they need. So let's see. Yeah, North Carolina also has something similar, and they've got their own logo and call sign, NC4AX, without a lot of information about what it is, but there's a database to go find out if you're part of it, I guess. And then there's this U.S. Oxcom Society that I came across, although it's kind of North Carolina based, so I'm not sure what the deal is. These are North Carolina people. I didn't get down this far. ARRL attack on the NIMS ICS Oxcom model. That sounds like a that sounds like something that I'd be interested in seeing. Dan Henderson talking at the at Raleigh Hamfest. To attack the NIMS ICS training model and bark orders from ARRL headquarters in Newington. What the heck? I don't think I recorded this. Dan is going to be at the Raleigh Hamfest an error occurred. Disappeared entirely. So I guess we won't. I guess we won't be watching that. This is not entirely surprising to me. I have heard that there is some grumbling in the emergency communications arena, Homeland Security and HAMS in some areas, that the league has not fully embraced ICS NIMS, and maybe that's the case. Maybe it was the case a while ago. I don't know. So it's something we can talk about if we do a program like this. So that's just a sample. I think that HAMS and maybe non-HAM auxiliary communicators would enjoy and benefit from a show that kicks around these subjects every month for an hour or two. I think I could get the ARL to participate, maybe a few other luminaries, especially if don't keep showing video like that one that didn't play. Well, we'll see. I get some cooperation from the league, and you know, sometimes it's a little bit harder. So we'll see. We certainly reach out to HAMs around the country and around the world who want to talk about their experiences, as long as they don't just read us a press release. Got to be willing to talk. So that's my deal. You might have some ideas about this. The best place to toss them is the Ham Radio Now Facebook page. Oh, I need to dial that up. Let's see. This is the Facebook group, the public group. So it does not have a convenient Ham Radio Now address on Facebook. It's got this complicated address. But if you go to Facebook and look at Ham Radio Now, you'll see I've got the public group, which you have to be a member of to post, but I think anybody can look at it. And I've got the show page, which is different. And it's the first thing I put up. Makes things a little bit confusing. Probably should take down the show page. The group is really all we need. But it's not as public-facing as the show page. So, I don't know. anyway, that's probably the best place to air any comments that you've got about this. You know, don't send me email with just comments. The only people I want to hear from on email are people that are interested in being the co-host. Let's see. Oh, if you're having a hard time finding the page, let's see. HamRadioNow.tv, our website. There you go. That little Facebook link, book link, or this Facebook group link thing here, that'll get you to the group. And if you haven't joined it, you can join, and I'll discover that within a day or so and sign you up. Let's see. Yeah, I know not everybody likes Facebook. Almost everybody uses it. We all complain about it. That sounds like a show topic. You know, there are not, ham radio's got its own Tower of Babel. You know, there's so many different modes and ways to communicate. It's, you know, an embarrassment of riches, which is a problem when you're trying to put together a system for emergency communications. Everybody, especially digital, everybody's got their own favorite direction to go. And so that's a problem that needs to be solved, and one that we can talk about. Same thing with social media. Lots of different sites, lots of different messaging programs. Excuse me. Very similar to what's been going on in ham radio for longer than social media has been around. Okay, so if you're interested in the co-host deal, let me know. Right this way, sweetheart. I'm going to make you a star. That's what I wrote here. Doing my best. That's the cigar. Right this way, sweetheart. Casting couch right over there. Okay, Arvin, let's roll this puppy up. HamRadioNow.tv, if you enjoy the program, thank you for watching. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Call me. Over and out.